The Cape Cod Commission, on behalf of Barnstable County and the Barnstable County Economic Development Council, better known as the BCEDC, is seeking proposals from local or regional governmental or nonprofit agencies for projects that support recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic and resiliency to such projects in the future. Approximately $150,000 has been allocated for grants up to $25,000. Funds will be provided on a reimbursement basis, and matching funds are not required, but they are considered during application scoring. Final applications are due on July 9th, 2021, and awards are anticipated in summer 2021. I'm going to run through some examples of past projects that received funding. Those include the Lower Cape Community Development Corporation. They received a $25,000 grant to provide comprehensive business services to support Lower Cape-based small businesses, including educational workshops, technical assistance, and business development financing. Cape Cod Community College received $24,803, and they used that to develop and offer a community health worker program that addressed the public health needs of the COVID-19 crisis, along with a sharp rise in unemployment in Barnstable County in 2020. Cape Cod Young Professionals, otherwise known as CCYP, received an $11,545,000 grant that helped the organization offer a new laser-focused coaching program that provided confidential one-on-one and group coaching services to young working-age adults with the goal of retaining young adults in Cape Cod's local economy after the pandemic. Similar to last year's license plate grant round, proposed projects should address an economic impact of the pandemic and align with and support implementation of the region's Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy, or SEDS. Next slide, please. The SEDS is a document compiled by the Cape Cod Commission and a broad range of stakeholders that identifies the region's opportunities for economic growth and challenges to ongoing progress. There are 9 priority initiatives that are included in the current SEDS, and those include local business development, blue economy sector development, comprehensive and activity center planning, housing access and affordability, climate change innovation, regional infrastructure planning, transportation and air quality improvement, infrastructure development, and infrastructure funding. So proposals for these grants must demonstrate consistency with one or more of these initiatives, as well as direct impacts of the pandemic. As we review the application questions, we will discuss this consistency in more detail. And again, applications are available on the commission's website. Just go to capecodcommission.org/licenseplate. So we're going to step through each section of the application, and again, we can answer any questions at the end of the presentation. You will need a PDF reader in order to access the application. If you don't have one on your computer already, you can download Adobe Reader for free at get.adobe.com. Again, that's if you don't currently have one. So let's take a look at the application. The first section is basically general contact information. You'll need to provide your organization's or your town's name and your main location. And if you have more than one location, just provide only one. That's all you need to do is provide one location. Next, there's a space for information about project partners. Project partners are those who will be completing some of the work on the project. Will not be looking for letters of support from those not named in the scope of work task list. For each project partner, please provide a short description of their role in project implementation. For example, if an applicant is partnering with another nonprofit to implement a project, this section should say a nonprofit name. Staff members will create educational and marketing materials to support project outreach. The next section is project information. You can provide a name for the project and a brief description of the project. That's 100 words or less. There will be more space for task descriptions later on in the scope of work. Next, you should apply how the project aligns with the 2019 SEDS priority initiatives that we reviewed just a few minutes ago. The SEDS documents are available on the commission's website. And again, you can find those at capecodcommission.org/SEDS, that's C-E-D-S. The SEDS identifies the region's key economic challenges, and it sets a 5-year plan of projects and initiatives that help address these challenges. For this question, applicants should name the specific initiatives that the project addresses. And project proposed projects don't have to come from the action plan list directly. These are examples of the types of projects and initiatives that the license plate grant fund can support. The next question on the application relates to the region's economic goal of increased resiliency or ability to withstand or adapt to systemic shocks like the recession or our current pandemic. Currently, a large percent share of our economy relies on seasonal tourism and hospitality. A more resilient and sustainable economy would provide more year-round employment opportunities in industries that pay high wages. Applicants should describe how the proposed project increases our region's resiliency and sustainability, increasing our adaptability and quality of life for people who live, work, and visit Cape Cod. In the next question, applicants should describe which impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic the proposed project addresses. Applicants should identify impacts that their organization or the people which they serve directly experienced, or describe measurable regional impacts supported by research and data such as unemployment or financial impacts to the organizations. One potential data source is the 3 Cape Cod Business Impact Surveys conducted by the Cape Cod Commission and the Cape Cod Chamber of Commerce between May 2020 and January 2021. Survey results are currently available on datacapecod.com. The surveys identified accommodations, food service, arts and culture, retail, and service-based businesses as some of the most heavily impacted industries on Cape Cod. They also identified a need for support in digital communications and marketing as businesses try to reach customers online. Previous questions asked which initiatives will be supported and pandemic effects will be addressed. The next question asks how the proposed project will address them. So applicants should describe two things. One, how the proposed project supports economic recovery, how the proposed project will support progress on one or more of the 9 SEDS initiatives. And secondly, how that project supports economic recovery from COVID-19. For each SEDS initiative and pandemic impact mentioned in the previous responses, applicants should ensure that they describe how the project addresses them in this response. The last question in the project information section asks if there are any anticipated challenges to project implementation, if there are any partnerships that need to be formed, permits to be secured, or votes that need to be taken. These should be identified in this response. If the grants are awarded in August of 2021, the applicant should be prepared to start on the project shortly after. So the next section covers the scope of work and project timeline. Applicants should name the task, provide a brief description of the work to be accomplished under that task, and that includes the work of any potential partners, and name the deliverable of the project. So for example, if the initial task is a public input survey, the description should name who will be designing and sharing the survey and how it will be issued. The deliverable would be completed survey results. The estimated completion date should provide at a minimum a month and year, but be more specific if possible. All of these projects will need to be completed within 1 year from the date the grant was issued. There is space for 5 tasks within the application. If you need more space, you can attach up to 1 additional sheet with the same fields, task name, description, deliverable, and estimated completion date. So the next section is a proposed staffing plan for the project. For each individual participating in the project, please share their name, title, associated hourly rates, and number of hours dedicated to the project. This section applies for both the applicant staff and for any volunteers. Volunteers' time contributions can be included in the project costs as a match provided to the project. Please list your volunteers in the staffing plan and use the federal rate of $28.54 an hour to calculate the value of volunteer contributions. If there are project partners completing the work on the grant, they'll be included in a separate section in the budget. Once you fill in the hourly rate and the number of hours for each individual, the PDF form will automatically calculate your total project cost. And that total project cost includes both the amount you're requesting through the license plate grant fund program, as well as any match you were able to provide. And again, those matching funds are not required, but they are considered during the application review process. The total project cost should equal the sum of the amount requested and the match amount. And if you're not providing a match, enter zero in that far right column, and the total project cost and amount requested should be equal. If you need to add additional staff members or volunteers, you can add up to one additional sheet that includes those same columns. Ensure the total project cost does still equals the hourly rate multiplied by the number of anticipated hours in the new sheet as well. Please calculate your fringe cost as a percentage rate applied to the personnel cost. Fringe benefits may include holiday pay, vacation pay, health and dental insurance, Medicare, retirement, and other benefits offered by your company. Fringe expenses are applied to employees' salaries only and should not be applied to volunteers' time contribution. And to calculate total fringe, multiply total personnel cost, excluding any volunteers' expenses, by the fringe rate. And the PDF form will then sum the number of hours, overall personnel cost, amount requested, and match amount for this sheet only. You cannot override the totals in this sheet to account for multiple sheets. If you've added an additional staffing plan sheet, please include an overall total line on the new sheet, a total line for the first sheet, and an overall project total, and that'll sum the number of hours, project cost, and amount requested, and match amount each for the entire project. You please also include a line for the fringe rate if you included one in the first staffing plan sheet. On the following page, for each staff member or volunteer listed in the staffing plan, please provide a short description of their tasks and responsibilities within the project. Again, you don't need to include the project partner's task. The section in the general contact information on project partners should have provided a short description of their roles and responsibilities. The last section of the application is the budget. Applicants should fill in all budget categories relevant for the proposed project. And the budget categories have been pre-filled for you. If there is a category you need that is not included, please list that information in other, including a category description in the narrative. For each budget category, please fill in the amount requested, the match amount, and a short description in the narrative as needed. The total project cost will fill in automatically, and the amount requested and match amount for personnel and labor and fringe benefits should exactly match the overall totals calculated in the staffing plan. But again, if you had to use that extra sheet for the staffing plan, please make sure the totals match the overall staffing costs across both sheets. If you're traveling or purchasing any equipment or supplies as part of your project proposal, please include the amounts and description here. Please note that equipment means tangible personal property having a useful life of more than 1 year and per unit acquisition cost equal to or exceeding $5,000. Supplies means all tangible personal property other than equipment. If you're hiring a consultant or contracting with someone to complete some of the work on the project, please fill in the amount requested and the match amount under contractual consulting budget category. This is not the same as project partners. Partners use funds to carry out program activities and can make programmatic decisions. Contractors provide goods and services for an agreed price. So if your project includes partners' expenses, please include them under the other budget category. Total direct costs is a sum of all the budget categories listed above: personnel, labor, fringe benefits, travel, equipment, supplies, contractual consulting, and other. This row has formulas entered and should calculate automatically. Indirect costs are those costs incurred for common or joint purpose of the organization, benefiting more than one cost objective, program, or project, and not readily assignable to the cost objective specifically benefited. Examples of indirect costs are things like administrative salaries, utilities using telephone, gas, and electric, education, office, and computer equipment repair, postage and express mail, printing, except for specifically identified projects, miscellaneous contractual services, including trash removal, office supplies, equipment and room rentals, and office lease. If your organization has a negotiated indirect cost rate agreement or a NICRA with a federal agency, please use the negotiated indirect cost rate specified in the agreement and attach a copy of the NICRA to your application. Organizations that have never had a NICRA with a federal agency may elect to charge an indirect cost rate of 10% applied to modified total direct costs, that total direct costs include excluding equipment. And so again, applications are due on July 9th, 2021. All proposals will be evaluated by the BCEDC. The BCEDC reserves the right to request additional information and or an interview, and in some cases, modifications to the proposed project. Final recommendations will be made to the Barnstable County Commissioners, who will make final awards. We are happy to answer any questions you may have. Please enter your questions in the chat box if you have not already. And we have Jennifer Clinton, our staff member, Jennifer Clinton, Community Development Planner. Hopefully I got your title right, Jen, as well as Maria McCauley here to answer those questions too. And so we do have a question, Jen, if you are ready, from Barry Margolin. Can you see that in the chat or would you like me to read it?
Could you read them? That would be helpful. Thank you.
Sure. So Barry's asking, if the proposal is part of a larger project that will continue through the end of 2022, but the tasks to be funded through the grant will be completed within 12 months of receipt of the grant, is the proposal eligible for the license plate grant fund program?
So as far as I understand, as long as the tasks included in the proposal for the license plate grant fund, as long as those components are completed, that should be acceptable. But Maria, if you have any further clarification on that, please feel free to let me know.
The tricky part in this situation is to make sure that you are not receiving funds from two different sources for the same tasks. So basically, it would have to be very clear in the grant proposal and also later on in the documentation that you only received LCP funds for task 1, 2, and 3, and then you had another source of funding for task 4, 5, and 6. But it's you just cannot put two scopes of work or apply for funding for the same scope of work from two different sources.
Barry had a second question. If partner organizations are identified as participants in the tasks included in the grant proposal, should they submit letters of support? And if so, how are such letters to be submitted?
So I am checking our plan for the project partners. I believe we do not need any letters of support for organizations that are, you know, in favor of your work. It's not necessarily going to influence the findings of the BCEDC, but what we are hoping for is a letter of commitment. So if you do have a named project partner, we want to make sure that they're aware of the hours and the tasks that they are being named on. So if you could attach a letter as a PDF to your application, that basically would align with the tasks identified in the scope of work and in the staffing plan, that would be ideal.
A third question from Judith Underwood. She would like to know, do we know approximately which week in August we will announce the awards?
That's a great question. I think that is going to depend on which commission meeting the BCEDC recommendations would be when the recommendations would be in front of the commission. So I would think it would be closer to the end of August.
And those are all the questions we have right now in the chat. I would encourage any of the other participants, if you have questions, feel free to type them in. Jen, is there anything else that you feel folks should know about the license plate grant fund application process?
I think we covered most of the questions that we typically get, but I did want to say that if anybody has any questions while they fill out the application, please don't hesitate to reach out to the commission. You can email bcedc@capecodcommission.org if you have any questions that we haven't answered yet, or if something comes up while you're filling out your application before July 9th.
And we have some more questions coming in. Bridget Alexander would like to know, can we go more in depth on what this grant program will fund?
So the license plate grant fund is intended to provide quick and flexible funding for organizations, nonprofits, and municipalities that are trying to support local and regional economic recovery. It really has run the gamut on the type of projects that it is. As long as whatever the proposed project is has a nexus with the 2019 Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy and helps to address some of the economic impacts of the pandemic, I think it would be up for consideration.
Another question, is it possible to have a sample completed application available for reference that could be a made-up proposal?
I think we can do that. I will confer with some of our other staff members that have helped in the past, and I can share that. It would be posted as an example to the commission website.
Bridget wants to know, are capital projects eligible?
These are grant awards for $25,000, so or up to $25,000. So not sure if we can even talk about capital projects here, but the question will be whether it aligns with the SETS 2019 guidelines and initiatives. So it's not excluded.
And again, all of those SEDS initiatives and guidelines, et cetera, are available on our website, the SEDS. You can find at capecodcommission.org/SEDS. And you can find the license plate grant fund at capecodcommission.org/license plate. Amanda would like to know, if this grant is funding only part of a program, is there a place to reflect that in the budget?
No, Amanda, right now there is no way to reflect that. I would say you should just include that in a description in one of the fields earlier on in the application and describe the situation.
So again, we are recording this presentation. It will be available on our website and the places that I just mentioned. Jen and Maria, anything else from you both?
I think that's everything. Like I said, if anyone has any additional questions while they're filling out their application, please feel free to reach out to any of the three of us or at bcedc@capecodcommission.org.
And thank you all so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Good luck with your applications.